Hi folks, this is Richard Hall and we're here with the night sky. We've got some special stuff set up for you tonight because there's a sort of a wonderful planetary alignment occurring. So we'll go over to the laptop. What are we doing? Wrong. Okay. Okay, hi, this is Richard here, and are we on to this yet?
Excuse me, listeners, looks like the vision that we were hoping to have for the television viewers is not happening, something weird happening with our thing, but I think Richard will continue with his programme nonetheless.
Yeah, no problem. Okay, well, what we're planning to talk about tonight is, first of all, is the tour of the planets. We've got an unusual thing occurring, which I'll explain in a moment, as far as all the planets are concerned. Then we look at the winter stars, and then finally this island Earth. Okay, so moving on, first of all, two of the planets. There is five planets which are visible to the unaided eye. There's lots of others like Pluto and Neptune, because these weren't discovered until the telescope was invented. But there were five planets, and planet actually means moving star. Originally, of course, the moon and the sun was included in that, and that gives you the names of the 7 days of the week. But normally you could only ever see one or two of them in the night sky at any one time. But what we're going to be having is that over the period, we're going to have just about every planet's going to be in the sky at that time. Now, as we go into the evening, and I'm sure you've already noticed it, there's a big bright star in the northwestern sky. And this is the evening star. It's the planet Venus. And we see it in our evening sky once every 18 months. And indeed, Venus is so brilliant that you can see it in broad daylight if you know actually where to look. But it is also a very, very interesting planet, because when we look at it through a telescope, we discover and we measure it, we find that Venus is almost identical to the Earth in physical size, just a little bit smaller. And so, of course, over the years, astronomers and that have always wondered just what's out there. Well, trouble is, when we look through a telescope, we see absolutely nothing, because the entire surface of the planet is covered in cloud, deep cloud. We just simply can't see anything. And so for years and years and years, people speculated what was there. Knowing how far it's closer to the sun than the Earth is, astronomers and scientists worked out that the world must be tropical underneath those clouds, and all sorts of ideas came up that maybe that it was something like a carboniferous coal swamp, like the Earth was 300 million years ago. Hey, maybe even there were dinosaurs living out there. It seemed to be a sort of primeval tropical world, all covered in mist and so on. But unfortunately, when we eventually came to have a look at Venus, which Russians did, they sent a probe down to the surface of the planet, they discovered that, unlike being a tropical paradise, as it were, it was the nearest thing to hell that you could imagine. All right, the entire surface of the planet is covered in a dense atmosphere of carbon dioxide, and the temperatures are so high because carbon dioxide, as you may be aware, is a greenhouse gas, and consequently, instead of it just being a nice hot tropical country, because of all the CO2 there, the temperatures on Venus have risen to 600 degrees Celsius. It's the hottest place or hottest planet in the solar system. Literally, metal melts at these temperatures. This should be a bit of a warning to us as well. This is what CO2, too much CO2 in the atmosphere, can actually do. All right. In addition to that, the atmosphere is so dense because of the temperatures and that, the pressure there is about 100 atmospheres. Now, that's the sort of pressure you'd feel if you went to the bottom of an oceanic trench. Furthermore, the atmosphere also contains sulfuric acid. So if you were to land on this planet, you would be crushed, cooked, and then dissolved. And indeed, the very first spacecraft that went down to the surface of that, they only lasted a few minutes before the atmosphere corroded its way through the hull and so on. But the interesting thing is that when we look at Venus and we look at the analysis from the material stuff being brought back from Venus and so on, we discover that once upon a time, the indications are that Venus was indeed, once upon a time, a world like the Earth with oceans and so on. And that's all changed. Well, what's all changed? Well, over billions of years, and we're talking about Venus being a world like the Earth billions of years ago, the sun slowly increases in brightness. It's nothing in, you know, even over a few millions of years, but over billions of years it is. So once upon a time, the Earth was a frozen planet and Venus was indeed a tropical planet. But eventually, as the rising temperatures drove the oceans into space, up into the atmosphere and then into space, and the entire planet turned into an entire inferno. Of course, the same fate awaits the Earth in the future, but that's well away, long as we don't muck things up too much. Okay, well, if you look at, see Venus in the early evening, if you look just to the left of it and slightly nearer the horizon, you might just glimpse another star. And that's, in fact, the most elusive planet to see of all. That is the planet Mercury. Mercury is very close to the sun, and we only ever see it either in the early dawn or early just after sunset, but it's always very close to the sun. Very rarely do we see it outside of a twilight sky. It normally sets or rises quite rapidly. But Mercury, of course, is an intriguing little world. People wondered what was on it. Well, of course, when we sent spacecraft out there, initially, when you look at it, it looks like a moon. Well, it's a much smaller planet than the Earth, but Mercury is, in fact, not. It's like our moon. Our moon's made mostly of rock, while Mercury is actually made mostly of metal. In fact, it's a gigantic ball bearing of metals in space with a thin crust of rock. So we've still got a lot to learn about this planet, but it's certainly very, very different to ours. Seen compared to the Earth, it's actually quite small, around about the same size, but a little bit bigger than our moon, but that's all. But it is, as I say, made almost entirely of metal. Okay, now, once it gets dark and Venus has set in the sky, then you'll see this big bright star rising up quite high up in the sky. That is the brightest star-like object in the sky. It's in fact the planet Jupiter. And Jupiter, of course, is a giant of planets. In fact, it's bigger than all the other planets put together. Furthermore, Jupiter is surrounded by something like 60-odd moons. Four of them are the size of small planets, so it's got its own planetary system. So this is giant Jupiter. And indeed, Jupiter in many ways is more similar to the Sun than it is the Earth. It radiates more energy than it receives. Its gigantic atmosphere is made mostly of hydrogen and helium. All right. But of course, it's nowhere near the temperature of the Sun. And it says it's got these wonderful worlds orbiting around it, which the four largest ones, which are called the Galilean moons because they were discovered by Galileo, can be seen with a pair of binoculars under good conditions. Certainly if you see pick up Jupiter before it gets dark and there's too much of a contrast there. So you've got these planets. And we used to think these were just moons like the Earth's moon, but no, they're not. They're the most fantastic planets you could ever visit, all right? But I won't say any more on that because we'll be talking more about those later on. Then beneath Jupiter, as you're looking at Jupiter, you'll see this pattern of stars, which is unmistakable. And this is, of course, our Scorpion constellation, or Scorpius. And the reason why I'm picking up Scorpius is now is because underneath Scorpius is another star. Not remarkably bright. It's a bright star, but not remarkably bright like Jupiter. This is the planet Saturn, which is one of the most awesome objects to have a look at in the telescope. It's a Lord of the Rings. It too, like Jupiter, has got vast numbers of moons. But again, being further away, they're more difficult to see. But the largest one, Titan, appears to be like the Earth was at the very early stages when life was first evolving on the surface of the planet. And then beneath Saturn and rising up And it's unmistakable later on in the evening is this bright orange-red star, just about as bright as Jupiter. Well, that is the planet Mars, the red planet. And, of course, Mars, again, has always intrigued. I guess there's been more science fiction stories are written about this world than any others. We can see it through the telescope. We can see seasonal change. We see polar caps and so on. So it definitely appears to be a planet similar to the Earth. It's much smaller than the Earth, all right, only about half the size. But it also sports the biggest canyon on Earth, gigantic volcanoes, and also information is coming through at the moment, we're discovering, is the gases are tending to suggest there may well be life on Mars. It's always been debatable whether it was or not, but it appears, we don't mean really advanced forms of life, but maybe some sort of bacterial form of life. And we can tell this from the gases that are there at the moment. All right. So that's our that's the string of planets, the entire five planets that can be seen with the unaided eye stretch across the sky. Anyway, now we're going to listen to a little bit of music. And this one is going to be A Listen by Michael Toombs. Okay, folks, you're back with Richard and the night sky. And what I want to have a look at now is, of course, is we've been talking about the big bright planets, and we've had a little look at some of these things there. But, of course, there's lots of other things happening up there in the night sky. at this time of the year, in the early evening, the most brilliant regions of the entire Milky Way would come overhead. And this is, I guess the constellation easiest to pick up, of course, will be the Southern Cross, and that comes right overhead at that particular time. And if you hang on for a moment, I'll just... That's better. All right, we can see where we are now. Okay, and as we were looking at earlier, of course, when we look up there, we've got the Southern Cross directly overhead, then Jupiter, the Scorpion, all rising up in a great big line there with Saturn and Mars underneath the Scorpion. And then directly overhead, of course, we're going to have, this is the early evening, we've got the Southern Cross, which is dead easy to pick out because it's made up of big bright stars. And you've got the two bright pointer stars which are following it around the sky. Now, the Scorpion is also known, of course, as the Great Fishhook of Maui. And the Scorpion, of course, is a sign of winter. And by the time it comes, we'll get round about midnight, the Scorpion's going to come directly overhead. And as we're looking up at there, you can see the brightest region of the entire galaxy beginning to appear. It's, first of all, it's going to be low down, but by early evening, it's going to come right up above us. And let's go and have a look at that now. Now, look. First of all, before we go on that, we'll have a look at the Southern Cross. And if it's a really dark night, what you will notice is that there appears to be a black patch there, and this is called the coal sack. And it's not actually a hole in the Milky Way. It's actually a dark cloud, and these dark clouds are the raw material from which new stars and planets are being made. And all the way along the Milky Way, if you scan across there, you find these glowing patches of light. And then from this, new stars are being formed, and stars are not formed separately, they're formed in clusters. And we've got quite a few beauties here right near the Southern Cross. You've got, of course, the Great Carina Nebula. You can pick this out with the unaided eye, but I'll tell you what, for a big telescope, it's absolutely awesome. And right into the Southern Cross itself, near one of the bright stars known as Mimosa, is a famous star cluster called the Jewel Box. And it's called the Jewel Box because when it was discovered, the big bright stars in this cluster have got mostly blue, but there's also a beautiful red star as well. And the contrast between the two colours is quite amazing. So that's some of the stars up in that region of the sky there. Then let's move over to the left as it rises up, the great central region of the galaxy itself. And here, of course, you can see the dark clouds in all their absolute glory. And the other thing to bear in mind is that when we're looking up at this region, although I say this is towards galactic centre, we can't actually see the centre of the galaxy itself. And the reason for that is that we're actually inside the galaxy. And it's like that story, you can't see the wood for the trees. When we look towards that bright region of the galaxy that we can see up there, we're just looking at a neighbouring spiral arm. However, with the use of powerful telescopes and so, particularly infrared telescopes, we're able to peer through this cloud. And when we do that, we're actually able to begin to look beyond those clouds towards galactic centre. And indeed, it is quite an amazing place out there. The gas temperature out there is about 60 million degrees. Not necessarily that you'd cook in that temperature because the gas itself is so rarefied. But as we move in towards galactic centre, what we would discover is that that the stars become denser and denser and denser until eventually we get towards galactic centre. And in the sort of space between us and the nearest star here on Earth, about 4 light years, there's something in the region of 1 million stars at galactic centre. It's absolutely crawling with stars. However, at the centre is one place you wouldn't want to visit, and that, of course, is this gigantic black hole which lays at the centre. And it is, in fact, the biggest, obviously the biggest black hole in the galaxy. contains something like several millions of solar masses, and it contains several millions of solar masses, and of course it appears to be the solar system at the rate of about one solar system per year. So this is a gigantic anyway, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be having another piece of music on in a moment. If I can get this working here. We're back with Richard, and we're looking at the night sky, and we're just going to finish off today by talking about this island Earth. I can always remember when I was a kid many, many years ago looking at different science fiction movies, and I can remember this really famous, it's based upon a famous book, a story called This Island Earth. And in that, of course, the author is looking at all the different things that can be seen up there in the galaxy, all the different worlds. Just how many worlds are there, like the just like the Earth out there in space? How many varieties of different life? It really is like being on a little island in a gigantic ocean. And if we assume that our island is the only one that's got anything on it, and everything else around there, everything else is barren, I think it's a bit of an unusual experience. Even if you want to take on a religious perspective and say that the Earth was created by God, why would our God create more planets in the known universe than there are grains of sand on the planets of the beaches of the world, and only inhabit one of them? So undoubtedly, out there is lots of things out there in the galaxy that we wish to have a look at. So what would we find, and so on? As I said, when I was a kid, the only planets we knew about were those around our own such star, the Sun, and the only two worlds that looked like they could have living creatures there, of course, was Venus and Mars, which we've already had a look at. But of course, I've just discussed earlier, these both of these planets may, particularly Venus, may well have had biology in the past, certainly not now. But then we have to look out beyond that to the other stars out there in the galaxy. And there are vast numbers of them. And up until recently, we just didn't have the technology. We could see the stars, but we couldn't see the planets. It's like if I was on a planet going around the nearest star and was looking back at the Earth or the solar system, we'd see the sun as a bright star, but the planets will be so faint, and so close to the sun, we simply wouldn't be able to detect them. And that's all just changed over the last 10 years. We now know of thousands of worlds around the different stars out there, and more being discovered every day. Initially, we could only discover the bigger ones, like Jupiter. Same as if we were trying to detect planets around the sun from another star. First ones we pick up is the giants like Jupiter and Saturn. But as technology is getting better and better, we're being able to detect planets very similar to the Earth in physical size. We're only one step away, possibly, by looking at where these things might actually have a habit and so on. So, for example, as we're looking at Venus, once upon a time Venus, it appears, was like the Earth, and now it's turned into Inferno. In a like manner, we think of the Earth, but it's not always been a wonderful world like it is today. Most of its time, it's been frozen solid. So each planet has a window in time. And we've got to go out there and find those windows and look for those planets and worlds around other places. Now, and I guess, but by the sheer numbers of planets out there, just about anything we can imagine must exist out there somewhere. And then possibly also other alien civilizations. So that's where it brings me into talking about this island Earth. This is going to be all out at Stonehenge at 7 p.m. Saturday, July the 21st. And we're going to be doing this island Earth, and it's going to be the search for Earth 2 and alien civilizations. And we're going to have a really special program for you on this subject with some awesome photographs. Then if it's clear, we're going to take you out afterwards and you can explore the wonders of the night sky. So that's what we're planning to do. And just to remind you, Stonehenge is open just on the weekends and holidays at the moment from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. with guided tours at 11 o'clock. And hopefully we'll see you soon at Stonehenge and on that night. Remember, this island Earth.